We'll be in Matthew chapter 27. I'll be reading from verses 39 to 42. 39 to 42, we're in the midst of the crucifixion. And I want to bring out one particular section here. Matthew chapter 27, verses 39 to 42. And scriptures read as follows. It says, "And they that passed by reviled him, wagging their heads, and saying, Thou that destroyest the temple and buildest it in 3 days, save thyself. If thou be the Son of God, come down from the cross. Likewise also, the chief priests, mocking him with the scribes and elders, said, He saved others, himself he cannot save. If he be the King of Israel, let him now come down from the cross, and we will believe him." And Lord Jesus, this morning I do pray to you, Lord, please help us. We do thank you, Lord, for giving us your word and giving us this account, Lord, of this, your passion. And Lord, it's with a deep sense of reverence, Lord, that we read of this and your death. And so we ask you, Lord, that we not take this lightly, Lord, that you gave so much for, but rather, Lord, as we look into this, Lord, that it would work in our hearts, Lord. Lord, a work to draw us even closer to you. I ask you this for my sake. I ask you this for the church's sake. And I ask you this, Lord Jesus, in your precious name. Amen. And you may be seated. I was reading this and it struck me, and I've been trying to struggle with this on how to handle this, but I want to deal with this subject this morning of knowing too much. Of knowing too much. We spend a lot of time correcting ignorance in the world and not knowing enough. And we spend millions of dollars in this land on education, one way or the other, public or private, primary, secondary, post-secondary, however you want to say it. We spend a lot of time in the churches teaching and trying to help to correct ignorance. But there is a time when we can know too much. And that's what I want to deal with this morning, knowing too much. These were not unlearned men that stood at the foot of the cross. The chief priests and the scribes in particular, but even the multitude that stood there. These were not people that had never heard of the scriptures. These were not people that were unlearned. But these were people who knew what they were talking about, and they knew too much. But I want to bring out, before I get started on this, a couple of scriptures to go with this. This thing of where we know too much. In the book of Isaiah, in chapter 55, and you don't have to turn there, you can. I'll give you the address if you want to mark it and read it. At a later time, Isaiah chapter 55, in verses 8 and 9, is a section that's a reprimand from God. And God Himself speaking through Isaiah there said, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher, and my thoughts than your thoughts." I would ask you, how much higher is heaven than earth? It's higher than that. Whatever it is you think. How much higher is heaven and earth? That much higher is God's ways than our ways, and God's thoughts than our thoughts. And for us to think that we know what God thinks, for us to think that we have a perfect understanding of the ways of God, we know too much. We take too much upon ourselves. And that's what I want to get to this morning. As a matter of fact, in this verse right prior to that, God had said, "Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts." You see, our ways and our thoughts that we think are so right are not up to the standard of God's ways and God's thoughts. They're not on the same level as God's ways and God's thoughts. His are higher than us. And again, in the book of Psalms, in chapter 50, and I would read to you here several verses from verse 16 down through verse 21 in Psalm chapter 50 on this same subject of knowing too much and of being sure of who we are and of forgetting that God is higher than us. We read here in the book of Psalm, chapter 50, beginning in verse 16, says, "But unto the wicked God saith." And again, this is what God would have to all of the, and obviously the wicked are those who are ungodly, who are not reverent to Him, who do not understand, who do not humble Himself before Him. "Unto the wicked God saith, What hast thou to do to declare my statutes, or that thou shouldest take my covenant in thy mouth?" You know what he's saying there? He says, who are you to run around quoting the Word of God? Who are you to run around with the Word of God in your mouth and on your car and on your shirt when you don't even know who I am? You're wicked and you're ungodly. This is a rebuke. It's a stern rebuke. This comes from God to the wicked. It says, "Seeing," in verse 17, "that thou hatest instruction and casteth my words behind thee." He says, if you're not going to do what I say, quit saying what I say. Shut your mouth until you do what I say, is what he's saying. It's, again, a very stern rebuke to the wicked about even uttering the words of God. He goes on in verse 18 to correct these. And he says, "When thou sawest a thief, then thou consentest with him, and hast been a partaker with adulterers." Who's a partaker with adulterers? Those who rejoice in it. Those who would watch it. Are you speaking of pornography? Well, yes, but also before pornography was an issue, to that junk that comes out of Hollywood, that's nothing but about adultery, to sit and watch it and be entertained by it, or to the junk that comes out of Nashville, to sit and listen to it and say, boy, what now? A good song when it's about nothing but drunkenness and adultery. That's to be a partaker with adulterers. He didn't say you committed adultery. He said you partook of it. He said you enjoyed it. He said somebody did and you thought that was all right. This is the group to whom God said, shut up and quit quoting me until you live like I say to live. It says in verse 19, "Thou givest thy mouth to evil, and thy tongue frameth deceit. Thou sittest and speakest against thy brother. Thou slanderest thine own mother's son." He said, just running down your brother is enough to prove that you're not doing like I would do. God didn't run us down, but He constantly corrected us, and He loved us, and He instructed us. And He says, verse 21, "These things hast thou done, and I kept silence." Now think about that. He said, I saw your wickedness. I saw you running around. He said, now I didn't just jump on you and correct you. He says, I let you go. He says, I kept silence. And the next part I have underlined, thou thoughtest, so here's those thoughts again, thou thoughtest that I was altogether such a one as thyself. But I will reprove thee, and set them in order before thine eyes. He said, I will meet you face to face, is what he said. What is he talking about? He is talking about a time of judgment. He's talking about a time when he's going to make this thing right. And what I'm trying to get to this morning is this thing of God being higher than us, His thoughts being higher than us, His ways being higher than us, and for us to know that and to humble ourselves before Him, lest we should, like the scribes and the Pharisees, like the chief priests and the elders, like the multitude before the cross of Jesus, be guilty of knowing too much. To me, this is one of the great tragedies in the Bible, that those who should have known knew too much. Knew too much to humble themselves and bow at the cross of Jesus Christ. Knew too much to be saved. Decided rather in their pride that they would rather go their way into eternal destruction. And I believe, or at least for the most part, if not all, at least for the most part, to this day, suffering the burning torments of an eternal hell because they knew too much. Because they were too smart for God. And because that they were determined that they would continue in their own ways and their own thoughts. And I tell you, it's a dangerous thing that we should get lifted up in pride. It's for this reason that the Scriptures say knowledge puffeth up. What Paul was saying then, he says knowledge for knowledge's sake. If we get lifted up in our pride and that we're proud of how much we know. And I've graduated 47 Bible courses. And I have memorized all of my Bible verses for the last 12 and a half years and so forth. You follow me? Because that's the knowledge I'm telling you that we can know too much of. We can know too much about the Word of God without knowing the author of the Word of God. We can know too much about the history of the cross without not understanding the purpose of the cross. We can know too much about how church services are supposed to go on in a church without knowing that the Spirit of God is supposed to be the whole controller of the church service in the first place. We can know too much. And I want to look at this that they knew too much of. If you look what they preferred to Jesus Christ. First off, they preferred their own judgment. If you look and where they were standing by the cross, they decided to condemn Jesus. Why? Because they preferred their own judgment. They had their own judgment in mind. They had determined what they believed was right and wrong. And not only that, they had determined who they believed was right and was wrong. Now, I want you to understand something. When the Scriptures tell us, judge not lest we be judged, it means something there. Now, it's not talking about judging right and wrong. We're supposed to have discernment. We're supposed to be able to determine something is right and something is wrong. And it doesn't mean that we're not supposed to tell anybody anything they do is right or wrong. How can you raise your children if you can't tell them that something they did was wrong? That's not what it means. And when somebody that you know or that you work with or you're kin to does something and they look for your approval, you should have the discernment to say, that's wrong. I'm not going to stand with you in that thing. That's not what it means when it says, judge not, lest you be judged. What it's talking about is that judgment wherewith we look at a man or a woman and we say, you're going to hell. Where we look at them and we say, you're condemned of God. That's not for us. It's that judgment when we set ourselves on the throne of God and say, I have determined that you're not worth being saved. I have determined that you're not worth the love of God. That's the judgment that we're warned not to give. When it says, judge not lest you be judged, it's speaking of condemning our fellow man. And that's exactly what these did. They condemned Jesus Christ, whom, by the way, this world did not seek to crucify. Pilate said, I find no fault in him. But they insisted that he be crucified. He said, I'll release Barabbas. And the multitude said, crucify him! Crucify him! His blood be on our heads and on our children's. That's what we were told not to do. But they preferred their own judgment to the Scriptures. Jesus had reminded them in His earthly ministry, if ye had known what that meant, I will have mercy and not sacrifice. In other words, the whole point of the law of God was not to ordain little rules and regulations and create some kind of hateful thing by which we can judge everybody and what level they're on. You see, that's not the point of it. The point is that we can show mercy. The only reason we show guilt is so that we can show mercy. Why do we preach the law? Why do we preach against sin? So people might know they're guilty, not so they can remain guilty, but so they might seek the mercy of God. We're not up here trying to send people to hell. They're going there already. We're trying to show the love of God and showing them that in your guilt, you can find mercy. But these preferred their own judgment. Rather than looking at Jesus Christ with an open heart and with open ears, hearing. They had their ears shut. They had their eyes shut. They were blind. They were deaf. They'd already determined what was wrong. And they determined they would kill Him. They also preferred their own religious knowledge. Well, I don't know too many people that don't. And I'm just being straight up with you. And I don't care who they are. I mean, I haven't been around every group of people. But what groups I've been around have all been confident that their denomination had it all figured out. And I know I'm in a Baptist church. I'll include us. But Baptists, Pentecostals, Catholics, Methodists, I've been around them. I'm sure it's probably true of the rest of them too. Everybody seems to be convinced that their denomination has it figured out. Well, I hope we've got some things figured out here. I really do. But I want you to understand something. We need to be convinced that the real truth is Jesus. That's what we really need to be convinced of. If we get too carried away in how the church has done it for 200 years, we can fall in this kind of trap right here. Because these men were very, very convinced in their religious knowledge. They held their Sanhedrin by the law of Moses, although they broke a lot of the laws of Moses too. And they thought that they had justly condemned a blasphemer. Now, by the way, they weren't putting everybody to death in that land that Moses' law said to. You remember when they brought the woman before Jesus for adultery? You know that they had quit putting people to death for adultery a long time before. They were picking and choosing when they wanted to obey Moses' laws. And they were picking and choosing how they would do it. But they were confident that they had full command of the law, full command of the Scriptures. They were confident in their religious knowledge. They were, as a matter of fact, arrogant in their religious knowledge. And how can I tell you that you know just a little bit too much about your religion without knowing the Redeemer? When you start getting arrogant about it. If you know the Redeemer more than you know your religion, you won't be arrogant about it. You'll be humble about it. You can be convinced that the doctrines that are taught in my local church are correct without being arrogant about it. And if what you know, it comes from the inside, and if what you know comes from the Spirit of God being inside you, it won't cause arrogance. But if what you know comes from pride in who you are, in the church that my mother and father and grandfather and all the Smiths and Joneses have went to for 250 years, if that's what it comes from, it'll result in a fall. And you can go to the right church and be too proud of it. You can go to a church that preaches all doctrines correctly and know too much about the doctrines and not enough about the Savior who gave them. And they knew too much about their own judgment. And they knew too much about their own religious knowledge. And they knew too much and preferred too much their own righteousness. And this is what it really, really gets down to. And I brought it up in the midst of this all morning. But this is what it really gets down to. They were convinced of their own righteousness. And I preach this to you in this church because this is to the church. This isn't to the people on the street corners. This isn't to the people sitting at home. But this is something that we in the church must beware of. If we get too confident in our own righteousness, then we're useless. Our own righteousness, remember, it says it's as filthy rags. And the filth of those filthy rags I won't get into, but if you ever read about them, it's talking about disgusting rags filled with bodily waste. That's how good our righteousness is. It's the righteousness of Christ that we must see. But they were proud of their own righteousness. They sat mocking. Mocking. Since when is it ever righteous to mock? Since when is it ever righteous to belittle anybody? And I don't care who. I don't care who. Whoever that man or that woman is, regardless of what they've done, they were made in a similitude of God. We're not to mock them. But they were that convinced of their own righteousness. And I'll tell you what it leads to. It leads to being deluded. It leads to being deceived. It leads to being so deceived that you wouldn't recognize the truth when it was hanging on a cross in front of you. It leads to being so deceived you could speak the truth and not even understand the truth of it. When they said He saved others, Himself He cannot save, they were speaking the exact truth. He could not save Himself and save others. He had to give Himself up in order to save others. But they didn't even understand the truth of what they said. They were that deceived. Because they preferred their own righteousness. They knew too much. And so what do I bring to you this morning then? Rather than knowing too much about ourselves, rather than being proud about ourselves, rather than putting all the weight on who we are and where we gather to go to church, rather than putting our weight on that and how much we know about that, I'd say what we really need to know is Jesus. Rather than asking you how much doctrine you know and how much scriptures you know, rather than asking you how much of your family history is tied up in the church, I would just ask you this. Do you know that man on the cross? If they had known that man on the cross, they wouldn't have known too much. If they had known that man on the cross, who was there with them the whole time, They wouldn't have stood off mocking. They'd have been bowed down before him. They would have never put him there. We can know too much if what we know is about ourselves, about our ways, about our thoughts. If we know so much about our ways and what we like, if we know so much about our thoughts and all these little smart ideas that we've come up with, we'll exclude God. And we'll think, well, God has to think of this way. He has to think that way. And forget that His thoughts are higher than our thoughts. And His ways are higher than our ways. If we ever think we've got God figured out, we have missed it completely. If ever in your life, if you live to be 250 years old, if ever in your life you think you got God in a box, you have missed it. Well, we must be ever reminded that God's ways are higher than our ways. God's thoughts higher than our thoughts. It's not for us to be self-righteous, to be the ones who would judge the world. Jesus judges the world. We don't. It's not our job. But to seek after Him, knowing we don't know. If I can tell you anything this morning, is forget how much you know and look at who you know. Forget how much you know about that Bible. And as a matter of fact, when you read it, don't read it seeking to learn more head knowledge, but read through those Scriptures looking for Him. When you pray, don't do so to fit a pattern, but do so seeking Him. When you come to church, don't look to go through the ritual, but come to church looking for Him. They knew too much because it was what they knew. And I tell you, it's not what you know. It's who you know. I want to dismiss it with that thought. And again, this morning was for the church. So easy for us to get caught up in ourselves and what we know. But there's one higher, and it's who you know. I'll ask Brother Craig, if you have a song you can close us out with this morning. We'll dismiss with songs we normally do. Altars are open to you, of course. Brother Craig.